So consider a roulette wheel. We have 37 segments. That would be a European version, and we have numbers from 0 to 36. 18 segments are black, 18 are red. That makes up 36. So what's the 37th? That's the 0. And I'm not quite sure, I'm not a roulette player. Let's say the 0 is green. Okay, well, it's not important here. It's certainly not black, nor is it red. So now we create a new random variable. Okay, so this this x is going to be a random variable, and we define this random variable x as being the number that shows on the wheel. Okay, and we will later also number on wheel. Okay, the field where the ball comes to rest. And we will also use a second random variable, we'll see that later. We call that C, and that is gonna be the color on the wheel. Okay, so that could be black, red, or green, whereas X could be everything from 0 to 37. So let's perhaps make that clear here. That could be everything from 0 to 37. This could be black, red, or green. So now let's calculate some probabilities. The probability that X is smaller than 18. So, for x to be smaller than 18, that is all the numbers from 1, from 0, 1, 2, and so forth. Smaller than 19, that means up to 18. So how many different outcomes are these? These are 19 numbers, okay? 19 possible outcomes. Now, how many possible outcomes do we have? 37. So, now I think each of you would now immediately possibly give the right answer and say, well, that means the probability is 19 over 37. And this is correct, and the reason it is correct is because each of these 37 outcomes is equally likely. Okay, so that's quite intuitive. So then, if that is true, what is the probability that x is equal to 0? Well, that's only one possible outcome, and one possible outcome means the probability is 1 over 37, the same as one possible outcome on a roll would be 1 over 6, on a dice would be 1 over 6. So 3, the probability that the outcome is larger than 0 and smaller than 19. Now, what possible numbers do we have here? Almost the same as up here, okay, but not including the 0. So the possible outcomes here are 1, 2, or the ones we are considering, all the way up to 18. So these are 18 numbers, and how many possibilities do we have? 37. So the probability here is 18 over 37. Okay. So then 4 is the question asks for the probability that x is larger or equal to 30. So here let's think, what's the possible outcomes? Large or equal to 30, that means 30 is included, 30, 31, and so forth, all the way to, we know, the largest possible number is 36. These are 7 numbers. Therefore, the probability is 7 over 37. And lastly, what is the probability that C equals to plug. Now, we have to be careful. We, in the same logic as before, we would say, well, plug is one of three possible outcomes. So is it 1/3? And the answer here is no. And why is it no? Because the outcomes black, red and green are not equally likely. And let's see why not. Because we are being given information that 18 segments are black, 18 are red and 1 is green. One segment, that with the 0, is green. Now, we know since each of these segments is equally likely, therefore, the probability for plug is what? It is 18 out of 37. So it is 18 out of 37. Now, the probability for red would be exactly the same because there are 18 segments in red. What would be the probability that the color random variable is green? Well, there's only one segment with the color green, that's the green one, therefore that probability would be 1/37.
So let's look at question 2 of the exercise. We're using the student survey data. I have here the Excel sheet. Now in the one which you download from Blackboard, of course you first need to clean this column. I have done that here already, but you need to do it yourself. You've been given instructions. Let's see what we are being asked to do. We create a joint frequency table for the random variables news and FE. That was the freedom and equity table. Now I'll show you how to use pivot tables. Actually, I have that here already. Let me delete this first. So if you just have your data file, the easiest way to get these joint frequency tables is the following. Go to Insert and there's a pivot table option and say pivot table. And Excel would recognize there's a table with data and will automatically select it. And just click OK, have new worksheet ticked. So now you have a new worksheet. Let me call that pivot table. So here you can create all sorts of things. You can see here with something which already indicates there may be something like a joint frequency table being created. The variables we want is the news variables, and you can actually just drag that over here, and the FE variable will drag that over here. Okay, so it realized we want to do something with these, doesn't really know what to do with it yet. You can already see that we can actually select what we want here, and I think as far as the news variable is concerned, there are some no answers, so we want to untick the no answers. Otherwise we want all of them. Now you can see something is quite curious here. There's two nevers. Looks the same. But there's supposed to be some slight difference in the formatting. All the others are unique. So that means actually what we're gonna do is we are first going back to the data in news. So there's something strange going on in news. So we highlight everything, go to data, sort, and we will sort according to news. And so you can see here, when you sort, you have to make sure you highlight the entire table so that you're not only sorting one column. So here we have never, all sorts of nevers. They all look the same, but apparently EVUs recognize that there are two slightly different versions of never. What we're going to do is we take that one column and say copy, control C, or we can highlight it, and now we just drag this down, but be careful, just over all the fields that say never. But now we've basically copied one version onto all others. So if you now go back to the pivot table, perhaps first drag this back, and now we'll drag it in again, and we still have two nevers. So perhaps what we'll do is I'll just delete the pivot table first, and we create it then again. So insert pivot table, okay. Let's see, news. Ah, okay, here you see, there's only one never left. And the other one was FE. What have we got here? So here we want to ignore the blanks and the no answers. Now there are some funny answers in here, no and yes. There should really only be agree with statement A or agree with statement B. Look at the legend for the FE statement. There's agree with A and B. That's look at FE, so we'll do the same trick as before. We highlight all our columns. We'll go to data, sort, we'll go to FE, okay, and we have agree with, we can, so agree with statement A, agree with statement B, and neither, and then there are a few. There are a couple of empty cells here and there are no answers, but there are a few no's and yeses. And I'm not quite sure why they have slipped in, but they are not really answers to our question. Now that will always happen if you do surveys, you will just find some rogue entries. So we will basically ignore these no's and yeses because they don't make no sense. So let's go back to our pivot table. I wanted to call this pivot table. Here we go. And we'll ignore the no, the yes, and the no answer. Okay. That was being asked for. So having agree with statement A, agree with statement B, and then we will have so no, yes, blank, and no answer. That's ignored. Okay, so now we have the table set up as we wanted. We still need to count the frequencies. Now there's an easy way to do that. You need to find some sort of column where we have entries everywhere. So that would, for instance, be the student column. Every row has an entry there. So what we do is we take that student column and we drop it in here. Now, down here you can see what actually happens. Okay, at this stage, what it will do is it will, for all responses which agreed every day and agree with statement A, it would have gone to the student column and would have summed the values in here. That's not what we want. What we want is actually count. So you go here, click on the little triangle, and there is, you may not see that, actually I need to make this a little smaller so you can see it. So the sum of student here, so you click on this one and you will see that there's a value field setting. Click on this one and here, instead of sum, which is what we just calculated, choose count. Okay, we just want to see how many values do we have in here, because that will count the responses. So click, go back to here. So now we have our response and you can see we have 554 in total. Let me create a new sheet here, exercise 3. And now what you can do, if you know you will need this later, you can highlight this, control C for copy, and we can just paste this in here. Okay, actually what you've done now is you've pasted the whole pivot table, so we have a new pivot table. Actually undo this, and if you go to home, paste, and just say paste values, it will just have the table. Okay, that's enough for us for the time being. We'll just include a couple of pretty lines in here to make it easier to read. Okay, so this would be the answer to question 2A. Question 2b. On the basis of your answer to part A, create a joint probability table. So this is our frequency table, and we want a probability table. The easiest way to do that is we copy this. And I paste it first. But now we don't want these values. We want values based on the frequencies up here. So these are counts, or let's call them frequencies. And here we want probabilities. So you could do all of this by hand, of course, but I'll just do it in Excel. So what do I want? This one. So the joint probability that someone answers every day, they're going to check the news and they agree with statement A, is 31 divided by the total number of respondents, 554 in this case. Remember, we've excluded some respondents. Result is 5.5% approximately. So now you could, of course, write this formula, corresponding formula, into every cell. Okay, but that would be a little bit tedious. It would be easier if you could just copy this cell across and then perhaps all the way down. Now you see there's all sorts of problems. It doesn't really like it. Why doesn't it like it? See, here we had this number divided by this. Once we copy the cell across, it will move the references. So it will divide this by this, but there isn't any number, therefore division by zero. So what we want in this formula, this value, the E11, we want to fix that. Press F4 or manually include the dollar signs in front of the E and the 11. And now we can copy this across and then copy this whole thing down. And here is our joint probability table. Okay, so all these numbers will sum to 1. These are the joint probabilities. Here we have a marginal distribution. They will sum to 1. Here we have a marginal distribution, and these numbers will sum to 1 as well. So that was part B. Part C, calculate the joint probability table assuming that the answers to news and FE are independent of each other. Ah, now it gets interesting. So I will again, I'll start from here. I'll copy that across. Just one field high up. So it's copied across. And of course, these values aren't the right ones, but at least the structure is the right one. So now I want these joint probabilities assuming independence. Now, firstly, what we want to do is we need the marginal probabilities here. So what I do is I highlight this, Control C for copy, and now I paste values in here, and I take these, Control C, and then I paste values in here. So these are not formula, these are just now values. So what is going to be the joint probability? So I'll say probability independence, okay? Probabilities assuming independence. That's very important. This is the observed probabilities, and here probabilities assuming independence. So what is the joint probability that someone reads the news every day and agrees with statement A? Given independence, it's going to be the product of the two marginal probabilities. It's this probability, marginal for everyday news checking, times this probability, which is the marginal probability of agreeing with statement A. So it's 0.05777. So it's not much different, this one to this. So again, we want to complete this whole table. If I just copied, I would get these zeros. And the reason is it wouldn't refer to the right cell. Okay, so now we'll do a little bit of Excel magic. Let's highlight this field again. Now this blue reference should always stay in column K, okay? So even if we copy this cell to the right, we always want to refer to that 0.11 191. So that means we want to fix that column K. That means we put a dollar sign in front of the K. Now what about that H22? If we eventually copy this cell down, if we did it as it was such, that H22 reference would move down as well. We don't want that. We always want that to remain in row 22 because that's where our marginal probabilities are. So here we put a dollar sign in front of the 22. So if we now first copy them to the right and now copy them down, we will get our joint probability distribution. Now let's just make sure that is indeed a joint probability distribution. So then the numbers which are red now, this is the joint probabilities assuming independence. Let's just calculate the sum. There should of course sum to 1 as it is a joint distribution. Phew, they do indeed sum to 1. Okay, so this is now our joint probability distribution assuming independence. That was part C. Part D, calculate the conditional probability distributions for the random variable news conditional on the outcome FE being agree with statement A. Okay, so let's, again, I'll just copy the structure. Paste values, so conditional distribution, and we have, let's have that here, conditional do it in the short form. Conditional news conditioned on FE being equal to agree with A. Okay, so how do we do this? Let me again delete these values. So the way to do that, there are several ways. The easiest one is to take the value we have in this field and now divide it not by the total number but divide it by only the number of those who agree with A, and that is down here, that number. Okay, and there's only one issue that arises now. If I copied this cell down, I would again get some gobbledygook because this reference, the total number of those agreeing with A, but this reference field was moved down. So what I really want in here, I want to fix this reference to this field, the B11 reference I want to fix. So I just press, I want to fix the row, so I'll put a dollar sign in front of the row. If I now copy it down, you can see that I get the right values always. Okay, double click on the fields to check it. Okay, now actually what I can easily, and that basically answers the questions, calculate the conditional probability distribution for the random variable news conditional on the outcome FE being agree with statement A. Now actually let's just see, FE statement A was, I find that both freedom and equality are important, but if I were to choose one or the other, I would consider personal freedom. Okay, rather freedom than equality. So B was the other one. Let's actually see that if we copy that across, what do we get? We get different numbers. Let's see. We are getting now the conditional, the distribution for news conditional on agree with B. Okay, so actually I'll say A/B because I calculated that now as well. Let's actually check how these guys look like. We go to insert column, this one, and we can get two bars. Now the first bar, we can actually go to select data, the first series was agree with A, the second series, the series name was here, agree with B. Actually I'll just say B. And for this one, I just call it A. We know what we mean, rather than having a long name. Then the horizontal categories, they are these guys here. So click OK. Okay, so here we see. Now we could see, is there any notable difference between the two groups, A and B, A with freedom, B equality? But I don't think we can see any significant difference in terms of news consumption behavior. They seem to be more or less similar. So let's just check back with the question, but I think that's all we had to do. Yeah, that was all we had to do. That was part D.